Doctor Who, the TV movie. The Changing Face of Doctor Who. The cover illustration of this book portrays the Eighth Doctor Who, whose physical appearance later changed after an unfortunate incident aboard a spaceship during the last Great Time War led him to the planet Khan, where, after an equally unfortunate encounter with the Sisterhood of Khan and an ornate goblet, he regenerated into a vengeful and embittered incarnation that his future selves chose to erase from history. For a while, at least. BBC Audio presents Doctor Who, the TV movie, by Gary Russell. Based on the 1996 TV movie Doctor Who by Matthew Jacobs. Read by Dan Starkey. Out with the old. The Doctor was lonely. It had been a long time since he had last had the TARDIS to himself. In fact, not since... well, surely since... no, it had been so long that he could not actually remember having been in the TARDIS alone. There had always been someone there with him. Someone for him to educate, impart knowledge to, rescue from the fiendish clutches of some tentacled monstrosity, or make tea for. But recently, he had spent far too much time tweaking and twisting various controls on the six-sided, mushroom-shaped console that dominated the six-walled main control room. He was always abstractedly punching up destination after destination, and for the first time, finding none of them remotely attractive. The whole universe, the whole of time and space to roam in, meddle gently in, right a few wrongs and enjoy some marvellous picnics, and yet, he was bored. For the sixth time in a month, at least it felt like a month, but time was relative, especially in a machine that was dimensionally transcendental, he had reconfigured the interior of the control room. He had moved away from its traditional bright white neo-futurism, with its high ceiling and roundled walls, and gone for a much larger, more gothic, redwood-paneled affair, with walls stretching so far up that, at their apex, each one seemed to blend into the other. Each wall reflected the basic instrumentation on the corresponding panel on the console from which the ship was operated. Opposite the databank switches, for instance, the wall was row upon row of antique and modern books, forming the comprehensive TARDIS library. The space-time destination panel faced a wall with every conceivable form of timepiece. Another panel, which ascertained how dangerous or safe the atmospheric conditions at any given location may be, was opposite a tiny secluded garden area, with an ornamental church organ borrowed from St. Christopher's in Cheldon Boniface, his favourite English village. Beside that was a stone fountain, a tiny fishpond full of rainbow gumblejacks, and a small stone bench where the Doctor could sit and meditate whenever he felt the urge. Another wall was a massive filing cabinet, arranged alphabetically, although in 843 different languages, and full of the memorabilia collected after countless expeditions, adventures, and investigations. The Doctor still had not decided how to decorate the other walls, but he would in time. Probably. Above the wooden main exit doors, with their marble embellishments, was a massive circular indentation, inscribed with the most recognizable Gallifreyan symbol, the Great Seal of Rassilon. Smaller versions of the device dotted the rest of this room and others. The Doctor had long resisted displaying them. He was not exactly proud of his heritage, but was now reaching an age, nearly 1,000 years old, where it seemed to be appropriate to at least acknowledge it. He must be maturing, he decided, like a good wine. His most recent upgrade had been to alter the appearance of the console. In place of high-tech, touch-sensitive buttons were a series of gold-plated metallic switches, rods and cubes that had to be inserted into tiny slots, and countless dials providing the main control elements. The old scanner screen, mounted into the wall, had been replaced by one mounted on a flexible Z-spring that, every time he tugged on a rope, came out of the wall to wherever he was standing. The floor of the control room, and the rest of his TARDIS, was now covered with the same redwood as the walls, an attractive parquet. Surrounding the small steps leading up to the console dais were wrought iron arches, and a shiny brass railing topped off the now enclosed console area. This new look had a likeable touch of the eccentric about it.
"Very gothic,"
he had murmured after finishing the changes. Now, however, the Doctor was already getting bored, and he wondered if it was time to change it again. He had just sat down with a cup of peppermint tea, ready to read a book, a first edition hardcover of Herbert Wells's The Time Machine, inscribed personally to the Doctor by its author, who wrote that their time together had inspired much of it, when something odd happened. He was distracted by a sound, more like a murmur, that rumbled through the TARDIS, as if from under the floor on which the Doctor stood. That was quite possible, of course. The interior of the TARDIS, while not exactly infinite, was both vast and labyrinthine, with possibly hundreds of different rooms above and below the one he was in, let alone the ones to every side. A long corridor wound away from the control room, and frequently, and often at inopportune moments, the Doctor would dash through the door during some emergency, only to find that the TARDIS had reconfigured itself, and he was lost. Of course, it might have been him who had reconfigured it. The more time he spent alone in his ship, the more frequently he forgot what he had done a few moments, days, or even years ago. It had been mentioned by more than one travelling companion that the TARDIS itself seemed alive, or at least somehow capable of responding to the Doctor's moods and subconscious thoughts. More empathic than telepathic. The Doctor had never contradicted such theories. The truth of the TARDIS, his TARDIS especially, was his secret, and a man needed his secrets.
"One day, Professor, I'm going to get you to draw me a map of this TARDIS of yours. Then I won't get lost, and I can make you a copy, so that you won't get lost either."
Ace had said that once. Ace. She always called him Professor instead of Doctor. Like a nickname, really. Yes. Ace. The Doctor rarely interfered with his former companions' lives once they had moved on, but Ace had always held a special place in his hearts, and recently he'd wondered what had become of her. He'd once offered her the chance to visit Gallifrey and become a student at the academy there, but she'd seemed less than thrilled at that idea. Was she off somewhere, living as some kind of outer space mercenary, freeing the universe from the tyranny of Cybermen or the Lobbery? Or maybe she was whooping it up in some 19th century French royal court, enjoying her experiences away from the drudgery of 20th century West London, from where she originally came. Like so many of his former associates, being far away from home and family, with whatever bad memories those associations held, made their ultimate destination more attractive. He'd once actually popped back to see her, or at least see what she was up to. Spying, as someone else had once said to him. He was in fact delighted to see that she had used the wealth of experience and sense of social justice he'd inspired in her to set up a huge worldwide charity based on London's South Bank. A charitable earth was there to help underprivileged children all over the planet. He missed Ace.
"I miss all of them, actually,"
he muttered to no one in particular.
"But especially Ace."
Then something extraordinary happened. He heard a voice calling, not from inside the TARDIS, but from inside his mind. A telepathic message which could only have been sent by one of his own people. It was very quiet, and he needed to concentrate to hear it clearly. Gradually, it became focused, coalesced into a distinct, familiar voice. It was the president of the High Council of Time Lords.
"Not today, thank you,"
he shouted.
"Oh, Doctor,"
the president replied, her voice both authoritative and strangely comforting, a voice that even the Doctor could not ignore. She always had that power over him.
"Doctor, we've received a message. A message that specifically concerns you."
"Not interested,"
lied the Doctor, who was, of course, instantly interested. The Madam President, knowing the Doctor of old, also knew just how interested he would be.
"I want you to listen to the message."
Madam President,
the doctor said.
If you forward it on, I'll give it a listen in a day or 30. Scout's order.
Listen, doctor.
And, with a strange electronic burble, the doctor felt, rather than heard, this mysterious message. A strong voice. A powerful voice. The voice of someone who was not used to being dictated to, argued with, or generally shouted over. Oh, yes. He knew that voice instantly, too. Today was a day of old voices, it seemed. Old voices. Or maybe old ghosts.
I do hereby make my last will and testament. If I am to be executed and thus cruelly deprived of my existence, I only ask that my remains be transported back to my home planet by my rival Time Lord and Nemesis, he who calls himself the Doctor.
The Master!
The Doctor flopped onto the floor, sitting cross-legged, and closed his eyes, concentrating hard. An image appeared in his mind's eye. It was indeed his oldest and most bitter rival, the Master, a fellow Time Lord who had spent most of his lives plotting to destroy the Doctor and plunge the cosmos into chaos, his sole ambition being total dominance over all living things. Like all Time Lords.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.